are a renowned British Muslim writer and activist, and you are also the co-founder of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, which is based in London. And you also work as director of research in this organization. Within that work in the Islamic Human Rights Commission, you have engaged also in the work of collaboration with the Alice Research Project, and specifically in the research that we're carrying out that focuses on human rights and other grammars of human dignity from the perspectives of the South and South and North. And just to kind of frame or explain this idea of the South inside the North, when we speak about this, we of course refer to those peoples and their thinking and practices that are produced as absent or as Southern inside the geographical North. And in this sense, the Muslim populations in Europe are part of this South inside Europe. We will get back to this theme later on, but for now maybe we could start by you telling us a bit more about the processes of becoming, of emergence of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, also in terms of what kind of considerations were behind the choice of the name.
Well, we set ourselves up in 1997, actually it was March, so we're getting on for 17 years since we were founded. But those of us, the five or six of us who came together to set the organisation up, had been working in the human rights arena in different projects. Some of it was kind of UK-based advocacy, others were, like myself, were working on campaigns for Nigeria, which at that time was under military junta. And all sorts of things. Bosnia had just happened, and there was a sort of a project that came on board in terms of tracking down war criminals and so on and so forth. And those of us involved felt that, you know, the time had kind of come to work collaboratively, both to share resources, but also to kind of be able to have a dialogue and a presence within the human rights community, which actually spoke to the issue of Islam as a discourse for rights and for justice, because we all of us came from those backgrounds, we were motivated by those beliefs, and yet within the human rights community at that time, even in its most well-meaning incarnations, you had a very strong perception that Islam was really against human rights, it was the cause of human rights abuses, and therefore Muslims were either victims of human rights abuses perpetrated by their religion, or they were perpetrators of human rights abuses because of their religion. And either way, it was deeply problematic. It was an, you know, implicitly racist assumption. And it also kind of belied the fact that if you look at the UN statistics at that time, and even now, the overwhelming majority of refugees were Muslims. And, you know, they were not all fleeing some kind of maniacal, monolithic religion. There were an awful lot of different problems going on, which most of them, the problems stem from right here in Europe. In terms of the name we chose, there was quite a discussion about it, and I was on the losing end of that, but I'm glad I lost, which was to actually put the name Islam into the title. I felt, and you know, I think we all generally agree it's sometimes a clumsy title, but we felt we had to actually kind of put into the forefront the name Islamic to challenge those notions, to be very in your face within the human rights community and say, okay, this is where we are coming from, and these are the terms with which you have to be able to be happy to negotiate with us on. It's not really up for compromise. And there's a lot of pressure on activists coming from all sorts of backgrounds, especially from our experienced Muslim backgrounds, who on the one hand are inspired by their faith, but on the other hand feel they have to repress that expression and conform to more general ideas or hegemonic ideas of what rights might be, and suppress that side of them.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, because an important part of the work that the Islamic Human Rights Commission does revolves around raising awareness and working against Islamophobia. And my experiences, what I've read of your writings, of the writings of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, the understanding that you have of Islamophobia is quite nuanced, and grounded on in kind of a specific historical facts, in the sense that it's an understanding that is grounded in a very thorough historical reading of different processes that have led and continue to kind of lead to this kind of reactions. So your understanding of Islamophobia is not this abstract notion that we perhaps might find attached to it, that pertains or tries to or understands Islamophobia as some specific individual's prejudice against Muslims, and that those prejudices are basically based on lack of knowledge, so that if you simply educate these specific individuals, then they will overcome this kind of Islamophobic intolerance, as it's also called. So this understanding, I see, underlines how the understanding that the Islamic Human Rights Commission uses, as far as I have seen, underlines how prejudice and intolerance towards specific groups of people are structurally and historically constituted through processes of domination and colonization. At this point, I would like you to expand a bit on this understanding of Islamophobia, and perhaps offer a few insights on how this connects to coloniality and racism.
I think where or how our writing sort of developed in this field really came from having to keep dealing with what were repetitive problems in terms of grassroots work. Mm-hmm. So on the one hand, you are dealing with those characters, these individuals that you have mentioned who have done something to another individual. And this is actually the dilemma of all people, I think, without wanting to overgeneralize, in Western Europe, possibly North America, in terms of how they deal with issues of racism, whether it's Islamophobia or another manifestation. That is this idea of living in a post-racial society, and actually we just have to sort out these crazy individuals who keep creating problems. And although the idea of Islamophobia was very much resisted for a long time by a lot of Western governments, there's a sort of acceptance now that something like anti-Muslim racism exists. And therefore, this idea has been very much promoted by those set governments and international organizations that, okay, this is the nature of the problem. Now, both in terms of our theoretical understandings, which in part are driven by interpretations of religious texts, as well as historical understandings and readings, and also in part because of really being able to see beyond what's happening on a local level, on this kind of government speak, we developed ideas that would be able to, if you like, break that narrative. Because it's not just a case of having an abstract fight about what does Islamophobia mean. It's actually very impactful in terms of how problems are dealt with on the ground as practitioners, as well as how you have to interact, as much as you may not want to, with governments regarding these issues. Now, we can see the long journey, I guess it's the phrase, but speaking from London, the sort of long history of, if you like, British colonialism, and how a kind of narrative of a dehistoricized narrative of what progress is, what rights, race relations, all of these things, multiculturalism, all these terms that we are sort of landed with, how they mask a reality of repetitive demonization and domination, and the two go hand in hand. And at the moment, the expression of, or the most blatant expression of that domination, is a kind of rampant Islamophobia, which ironically is tied in with the idea of human rights as well. And in the last 10 years, we've seen a huge shift in, or breakdown, how we like to see it, in the sort of narrative of human rights as something which is very necessary to protect. It's become, if you like, the expression of a British or European identity. But it's in order to protect that, you actually have to violate the rights of people who, in fact, don't deserve those rights because they're not really quite human. it's a kind of cyclical argument, but it's become very entrenched, which is that some people are frankly just not human enough to deserve rights. And that's not actually new, that's just, if you like, something that's coming to the surface that's been boiling under that narrative for centuries. And for us, we can actually see that time and again. Whether this time it's Muslims in the 80s, it was blacks in the 30s, it was Jews. We can keep going, non-conformist, and all the time women as well. We've always had that, those kinds of similar arguments made. And so, yes, we identify the structure as the problem, and that's why we kind of work towards models in our work that kind of break down these arbitrary boundaries of what are rights, but also what are the problems. And we can explore that a bit more with some more examples a bit later, maybe.
Yeah. But maybe I was thinking in terms of the structural aspects of the problem, or perhaps the structural nature. I don't know how to call it, but how does it I'm thinking more on how does it how is it expressed, or how in what terms? Because speak about structure is also a bit abstract, right? And you say that it's the understanding of your activism and the activism of the Islamic Human Rights Commission is also very practical. Sure.
Okay. So for us, I mean, it's become almost blasé to say, okay, there's Islamophobia in the media, or we're in the UK, we have institutionally racist organisations or facets of government. We've had a huge thing about the police being institutionally racist now for 20 years, this conversation in the United Kingdom. And for us, we take it as read that institutions, that culture are institutionally biased, and they're biased against Muslims, they're biased against most minorities, or quote-unquote minorities, many, many groups, and that hold manifests itself in both the way representation of groups happens in everyday life. So whether it's in the media, whether it's in political discourse, whether it's in the culture, there are all these manifestations, and it's not, again, those odd individual ones where there's something very blatant. It's actually underwritten. All of these mutually constitute each other, as well as in particular its manifestation in law, and law then again reinforces the idea that you have these problematic communities. So we just have had a raft of anti-terrorism laws in the last, actually, you could say 15, maybe even 17 years, before 9/11 in fact, which all specifically targeted Muslims, although it wasn't in the, you know, the wording of the laws, but in the implementation and in every assumption about them. I mean, nobody was under any illusion that really this would be the community that was targeted.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, they're justified by what politicians say, what the media has described as a problem, but also all the underlying cultural, I forget the phrase, not just representation, but, you know, the cultural philosophy of who has a right to be protected by the law actually manifests itself in those types of decisions, which then again reinforce in the minds of the majority, who are not as powerful as we would like to think they are, but are at least more powerful than minorities, and justifies and allows these things to pass without hindrance. For us, in the practical aspect of how that expresses itself, when we talk about Islamophobia, we are not just talking about what happens when somebody calls you a name on the street, or if while you are being beaten up somebody says something racist and anti-Muslim to you, which can all be actionable under the law as it exists. It's also about the fact that when you turn on the television, you feel that on the news today, you as a Muslim were maligned because of the way the reporting was in fact implicitly anti-Muslim. It's also about the fact that you go to school and there's nothing about you in the curriculum. There's nothing about Muslim history or other histories. And therefore you're excluded, and therefore you're demeaned in another way. So, you know, those are the practical outcomes. That's why when we measure Islamophobia and the models we've developed, we're not just talking about being slapped around the face or being called a name. We're talking about all these experiences.
Okay. Yeah. because you were speaking about a bit about representation and this kind of cultural philosophy or cultural assumptions that ground or like also in the kind of everyday but also structural sides of Islamophobia. And I've been thinking that this perhaps a good example of if you will the Western lack of understanding of the concept of jihad, for example, mm-hmm. That represents, and this is the media is a big actor here, right? It represents jihad as kind of this crusade against humanity and mm-hmm. this kind of retrograde holy war principle, which is inherently genocidal or at least homicidal, right? However, I also understand that the notion of jihad has nothing to do with that understanding of jihad. So in this sense, jihad can also be thought of as these other grammars of human dignity that the Alice Project is also interested in understanding more, right? So perhaps this is a good point for you to present a bit the notion of jihad as you understand it.
Jihad is a huge concept, and I'm probably not the best person to explain it, but there's an understanding amongst all Muslims, whatever their differences about interpretations, that there's a lesser jihad and a greater jihad. Mm-hmm. And the lesser jihad is actually the one where there are the physical battles. Okay, so you have the history in the time of the Prophet where certain key battles were fought mm-hmm. against different armies that led to, generally were defensive, but some led to victories where, you had the conquest of Mecca, which in fact wasn't a battle in the end. It kind of was just a conquest without violence, but you could still term a jihad where there was a kind of political changeover and okay. it became a Muslim governance over that area, and other battles which were just about survival. Okay, and they have relevance in the modern day and age as well. I mean, as much as we don't promote non-violent action, but there are times when people just have to defend themselves, and mm-hmm. that is part of the lesser jihad. But there's a notion of the greater jihad, which actually was something that was declared by the Prophet after the end of one of the battles, which was actually called the jihad al-nafs, or the jihad of the self, mm-hmm. or is often presented as that. And it's interesting that that's also been utilized by kind of Western discourses as well, but mm-hmm. I'll come to that in a minute, which is more about self-development, about perfecting the self and the soul. But there is another aspect of that, actually, which has been sort of lost in this kind of colonial period, and which has been reimagined by many of the social movements which have been described as Islamist in the last few decades, particularly, which is about social justice and struggle, which is actually about coming back and rebuilding society. It's all very well and good to kind of fight self-defensively to protect yourself, but then what do? You have to pick up the pieces of society. It's not just about then saying, okay, now I'm going to go off and be a good person and perfect my spirituality, which is all part of it.
Yeah.
And so jihad has many, many layers to it. It's individual, it's social. There's a small part of it where it might be necessarily, military.
Yeah.
But that has become, if you like, the huge focus, and in fact that's an example of where there's a malicious focus and a deliberate focus within some parts of the media and political discourses who frankly do and can know better, but for whom it suits the agenda to just have a convenient term which then goes on to demonize everybody who jihad is a very, very important facet of people's identity and belief in the Muslim world, and actually making them feel kind of very demeaned by the term. And therefore you get people not even talking about things like the greater jihad anymore. They don't just use what people now call laughingly the J word, okay? Let's not talk about the J word. Please don't use the J word. It often happens even when Muslim journalists or channels come to interview us and say, you know, whatever you do, please don't use the J word, because we can't take the hassle when we broadcast an interview that has something like that in it. It doesn't matter how nuanced a discussion you want to have. It's a red flag with which you can not just demonize people. I mean, you know, in a way we can sort of laugh about it, but, you know, you can actually get into very serious trouble if, you know, somebody decides to pick up an agenda with you.
Yeah.
You know, at the very least, you can just have a tabloid article saying, well, they are jihadists, look, they use the word here.
Yeah.
And that's your funding gone, and that's, you know, you under investigation, etc., etc. But this kind of idea of the greater jihad is something that's also been usurped. So that idea of it being an individual jihad is now something that's being promoted by this kind of socially engineered Islam that a lot of governments are trying to promote, saying, well, you know, but look at your text, the greater jihad is all about, you know, individual purification and spirituality, and that also is very dangerous, because as much as it's true, it's again becomes just a sole focus, and it's a way for Muslims to have a kind of acceptable interaction with the state and say, look, you know, they understand the greater jihad, but at the same time it's also about actually subjugating people to the political discourse. You know, so, you know, you've become very depoliticized, you're no longer talking about social jihad.
Yeah.
You know, which would be not just transforming the societies we live in for Muslims, but for everyone, and just kind of, you know, becoming a depoliticized, non-critical member of society.
I'm thinking, because, well, perhaps later on in this interview we can speak about the kind of the more decolonizing or transformatory potential and energy in jihad and other notions, but by what you're saying right now, I'm thinking that there is this difference in understandings or in representations concerning jihad. In practice, functions kind of like a cage, right? Because whatever you do, it is framed. It is from dominant society framed within a specific notion about what is right and wrong. That necessarily already has implied that jihad is wrong and even criminal, right? Because it follows. It follows this Islamophobic logic that we've been talking about. So, how does the Islamic Human Rights Commission kind of try negotiate within that kind of that space, because it seems to be very limiting and limited, right?
It's about control of language and control of narrative, and the problem is, and this is inherent in a kind of a democratic dilemma, is that, you know, you cannot, without having the patronage of power, have your language accepted. And the bottom line is that in order to control society, the ideas of society, etc., you need to control the language. And what happens in this kind of Islamophobic or racist or generally structural form of dominance that, as I said, just has been taking different forms, is that no other terms are allowed to be part of the narrative, you know, even in a sort of small kind of, oh, look, that's similar type of way, okay? For us, it's like firefighting at the moment. It's about trying to keep that language alive within communities, because the kind of fear that has enveloped particularly Muslim communities, I think it's beginning to sort of seep out to other communities as well, but particularly Muslims for 9, 10, 15 years now, is that, you know, we still need to keep talking about this. We cannot be scared of talking about the J word. We should, you know, at least with ourselves, be able to have these conversations. What do these things mean? Why are we inspired by it? What does it really mean? And, you know, there isn't, again, you know, an awful lot of consensus, but there is a huge discussion that goes on. And what we are worried about is not the fact that there are all these dissenting and sometimes for us troubling interpretations of the fact that nobody wants to talk about these things anymore, that even in our own spaces we fear repercussion, we fear there's so much kind of scrutiny and infiltration that even by using these terms in non-threatening ways we will still somehow be targeted. And whilst that might sound very paranoid, you know, I have to sympathise with it, because, you know, at the cliff face we're dealing day on day with cases where people are hauled into police stations. We're talking about people in their thousands, you know, tens of thousands if not more over the last decade or so, just in this country, for quite, you know, innocuous things. And it ruins your life, even if you're not charged and you don't go to prison. You come, you know, there will have been media attention, at least in your local community. Your neighbours don't want to talk to you anymore. Your family are paranoid. You probably lost your job. And, you know, even very, very much by about 2003-04, I think it was the case amongst pretty much every Muslim community that you either had some kind of interaction like this with the police or you knew somebody who had. We're now over a decade past that point. So that's a key thing for us. But, you know, the control of language and the control of the narrative is where we see the battle. So for us, we have to keep on saying things, we have to keep on writing about jihad, etc. And actually, for whatever reasons, we may not have been targeted that way, but then it starts becoming a way to ignore us as well. Mm. And that then becomes the dilemma, okay, if you want to be heard, you have to amend your language, but then if you amend your language, you become complicit in the problem. And that's an endless struggle for us as an organisation. So you'll find in our advocacy, we will just have to use in courts and at the UN, etc., a language that we find problematic, and then on the other hand still try and create a space where we can be interrogating those terms but also presenting alternative discourses, some of which are generated through thinkers and people we work with, and some of which are just people we totally disagree with, but we say, okay, but there has to be a space for that to be said. And, you know, respected.
To stay a bit with the media, or to return a bit to the media rather, because this is connected a bit to this issue of language, but also about Islamophobic representations in the media, right? It's this domination hate model theory that the Islamic Human Rights Commission has developed precisely in order to, because part of your work is also kind of in analyzing media representation, in displaying this kind of repetitive ways of representing and dealing with Muslim subjects, not only in the UK but across Europe and also in the US, right? In any case, I would like you to explain a bit to us what does the domination hate model theory, on the one hand, what does it address in terms of lacks of shortcomings in other approaches to analyzing the media and Islamophobic discourse and racism and the media, and on the other hand, what does it allow to display or to see clearer? So the contributions of this model.
The domination hate model of intercultural relations picks up on what I was describing before in terms of the constitution of anti-Muslim discourse. And for us, this could be any group. It doesn't have to be, you know, this is not something inherent or special about Muslims and Islam. The constitution of those discourses through law, media, politics, culture, quote-unquote, or education, all the kind of institutions of society and the facets of it, without these kind of arbitrary divisions. So on a policy level, you might want to talk about media, but you then can start sort of ignoring how it impacts elsewhere and also how it impacts directly on those people who say they are being demonized by it or victimized by it, etc. So I think where it addresses where there's been lack, I think it's in fact talking across these boundaries. So for example, just to pick up the idea of anti-terrorism arrest, just because it's a kind of very clear example. On the one hand, you have underlying narratives, which are based in centuries-old kind of stereotypes about others mm-hmm. and how they threaten society and the manifestations of that in this kind of idea of, you know, these kind of pre-modern barbaric men who love jihad, which, as you said, is represented as a kind of genocidal idea, which, for whatever reason, of not doing anything for all these decades, has now suddenly decided to manifest as a existential threat to the United Kingdom. I mean, I'm not kind of sort of exaggerating, just to use the UK mm-hmm. scenario. You do feel, if you read the broadsheets, that there is a kind of menace that will bring down the entire society from these essentially handful of people who could be anywhere hidden amongst these Muslim communities, and that somehow all the other people in those communities secretly support mm-hmm. ideologically. These guys, the domination hate model, can unpack how that idea is implicit in a lot of the media, how it interacts, not just in, I'm not talking just about TV news, but how that crosses over with current programming, how that also fits in with, for example, Jane Eyre, and mm-hmm. you know, big canonical works of English literature, and how that also then reinforces those policies and laws, and vice versa. So all that kind of cyclical exchange is something that is analysed. And then you can also make recommendations. Who's going to listen to them? That's another question. But the point is, it's about helping people understand how it works. We keep making a reference to examples of where discourse has changed in our lifetimes. Because there's a point where you can talk about structure and feel completely helpless and think, okay, nothing changes. We have seen it change, and we've seen it change with regard to particularly sexuality mm-hmm. in the last sort of 30 years, from the time at least when I was growing up, when this was a completely taboo thing, and any time you had representations of quote-unquote homosexuals, it was incredibly demeaning, to a completely different culture of acceptance, not without problems, but, you know, things which you could not have imagined in terms of representation. For us, that's not so much a model, but a point where you can say, actually, you know what? Media is not innocent, okay? Because media is often presented as this, and we often understand it to be an arena where if you can just get in there and make your case, it's a sort of level playing field. There had to be a kind of political motor and impetus in media institutions to make that change happen, and, you know, deliberately so. And for us, it's again saying, okay, when those who dominate wish to change things, it can change, and that's where media is not by itself, and it's not innocently representing and reproducing images that may just exist and then accidentally be a bit racist sometimes. Mm. You know, there is both an precedent for saying it is deeply problematic, as well as a precedent for saying there can be a political change driven through the media, in the media and through the media in society as a whole. And that's where I think we pick up on both the lack, but actually what we can actually present through it as well. And it's controversial, because you start talking about politics and you start talking about interventions which are external to the media, that gets accusations of tampering with free speech and expression and hampering artistic expression, whatever thrown at you. But the point is, well, that's been going on forever, and whilst we're not happy about it, you know, you have to give us a more convincing reason why it can't be done here, or why somehow we should believe in the case of Islamophobia the media is completely innocent and maybe accidentally reproducing contrary images, as opposed to being structurally at front.
Kind of a Pandora's box or something like that.
I think the media is one for self-justification, and you often get accused of labelling every single artist and journalist, etc., as a racist, and that's not the case. You know, we are all, to a certain extent, conditioned by racist ideas and may perpetuate them without knowing it. but you know, the kind of self-perception of practitioners in the media, particularly those at the very top, needs to be interrogated more robustly, and that's what the domination hate model does with all these different facets of society. It's actually calling out where there has to be accountability and responsibility in a political sense. It's not just a theoretical exercise for the sake of it. We do deconstruct, but then we do try and reconstruct as well, or give some idea about how it has to be done.
But in the end, in the end, maybe it all boils down to the recognition of the problem of Islamophobia, racism, as a structural
issue. And that also is part of the process, because again, even practitioners, academics, victims lose sight of that. And that's where you get this narrative that, well, if there was only a proper representation of Islam and Muslims, then people wouldn't have these misconceptions and therefore wouldn't commit these sporadic anti-Muslim attacks. And for us, the domination hate model actually argues that even those sporadic people who do these acts are in a way victims of Islamophobia and racism, because they're incited by the media, they're incited by political discourse. You know, they trust the media, they trust government. Obviously not on the things that affect them daily, they can interrogate that, but when you don't know Muslims, when 80% of the people in the UK say they've never met one, not because, you know, Muslims are insulated, but because of the demographics, okay, they mainly live in cities, etc. They're looking to the 9 o'clock news and the 10 o'clock news and what the Prime Minister says for guidance about who these people are. And it's not good guidance that they get, and therefore when they do see one, they may well want to smack them around the head and feel aggrieved or call names to them. And that's another type of victimisation. They are also victims. For us, yes, they are part of the problem, but they are not the problem, they're not the source of the problem. And that's, again, part of this model. You know?
Yeah.
It is the structure.
That's a very important distinction, right? Because in terms of, many kind of this critical understandings of racism, or critical racist theories, or decolonial understandings of racism, we have the one of the basic issues is that what racism does is to kind of create problem people, right? So that some people are implicitly understood as problems, be it in daily interaction, also in terms of how legal structures deal with these people, but in this sense that the it's interesting how the domination hate model also applies the structural understanding in terms of how the dominating society also creates to legitimize, in a sense, the understanding of racism as a problem of specific individuals, and creates also problem people within its own kind of community, so to speak.
That's exactly it. I mean, we've had in the UK an unusual phenomenon for the last 5-6 years in the rise of a very kind of street right movement, far-right movement. We had smaller things in the sort of 70s and early 80s, the English Defence League and sort of associated groups. And again, after a while, that became the focus of concern, in the sense of, okay, we have a rampant rise in Islamophobia because of these far-right groups, and our argument is, no, they are a symptom of the structure. Yeah. They are not the actual cause of the problem.
Yeah.
And they've become another convenient distraction. I'm not trying to diminish the sense of threat that people feel when, you know, groups of right-wing occasionally, you know, baseball bat wielding guys turn up in their area, not at all. But again, they are the creation of a much bigger problem. And unless we kind of see it and name it for what it is, we're forever going to be distracted, both by the bad guys in the Muslim community, as created by sort of very powerful elites in the discourse, as well as anti-racist, you know, this kind of other bogeymen that we can fixate on and then not really look at the causes.
To stay a bit more in this kind of structural
aspects of Islamophobia, and this is perhaps also related to the domination hate model theory, but I read a report that the Islamic Human Rights Commission launched in September last year, that was concerned about the problems connected to complaints about racism in the media and how these complaints are used to reinforce racism. Could you expand a bit on this point in terms of also what are these dynamics that are at play here in relation to possibilities of change? We already kind of have touched upon these issues, but it
sprang out of the advocacy work that we've had to do, and there have been many sort of movements, I think, in a lot of Western European, North American countries where encouraging people to complain when they see misrepresentation and demonization in the media, whether it's the news or programs, etc. And I think they've been, in many instances, quite successful in mobilizing people to come out and complain, particularly sort of around the early 2000s. On the one hand, we've encouraged people to do that, but we've also trying to get people to understand again the sort of structure within which they're complaining, because there is a sort of a projection of the idea of the complaint process as being the proper, the word escapes me, the proper solution for the problem of racism in the media, that you can, it is the right remedy, you know, it's properly remedial, and that, you know, you can make a fair case for, if you can make a fair case as to why something is problematic, it will be accepted. When in fact, what it does is actually simply disempower, in a way, many times the people who are complaining even more, in that you are continuously having to prove racism, as opposed to the assumption being made that actually, whenever you are, at least on the level that whenever you are talking about certain communities and peoples who are, by virtue of the size of their community or the social disadvantage, not properly represented. Okay, if you're always having to make them prove their case, you know, you're actually reinforcing the fact that they are marginalized, that they are discriminated against. That's using a model whereby you're accepting the kind of liberal premise that the media is a democratic space. Okay, even with that premise, you have to start acknowledging that dominant communities will always actually control the language, and therefore you have to have this kind of rectification where you don't have to put those people complaining on the back foot. And this is where we had a kind of momentous moment with the Stephen Lawrence inquiry 20 plus years ago, where there was an understanding of institutional racism, where there was an understanding that when a person complains about racism, they don't need to prove it, their perception is enough to prove the case. And this is something now that's become a huge critical fight with think tanks affiliated, particularly to this government, trying to kind of overthrow this idea of perception as a legitimate marker of where racism exists. And this, again, I should emphasize, is just within this idea of the media or other institutions as democratic, liberal democratic spaces. For us, of course, we actually take it as a read that the institutions themselves, working within the structure, are necessarily biased. Not because somebody, every single person sat down and said, we hate you, but that's the way it's developed, and therefore we need to tackle that differently. The complaint process within that simply pushes, not only pushes people onto the back foot when they lose, which they frequently do, because of the argument being used of free speech and legitimate points of discussion, it then further perpetuates the idea that Muslims in particular have an unjustified sense of grievance. And this is an exact quote of former Prime Minister Tony Blair, who condemned the Muslim community as having unjustified senses of grievance. It reinforces the idea of this kind of wonderful democratic space within the media, whereby it is not only acceptable but just and proper to quote-unquote, investigate or interrogate certain ideas without addressing the fact that, you know, when you have that conversation, you don't have an equal partner in the conversation who can respond back. it's not just a case of in one program having Julia sitting here and having a conversation with me and interrogating me quite vigorously and me being able to respond. It's the fact that that program is going to sit in a canon of programs for the last 100 years, whereby there's not too many people that, you know, come from my side being represented at all, except in a negative way.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the complaints procedure doesn't address lack. And lack is a huge thing that we never talk about, which is a daily form of violence against minorities. We just don't exist in any way. We keep talking about, well, there are positive news stories about Muslims. That's an example about it. But of course, the answer is because the news is not a very positive thing. Therefore, you know, it's always bad news stories. And the fact that so many just have Muslims is just a fact of life. We don't interrogate why there might be so many Muslim stories that are bad.
Yeah.
Or why it is that we focus on them. It's just seen as a very objective space. So while I may have gone slightly off the point there, your complaint is always bound to fail.
Yeah.
So for us, it was important to, you know, not just for the institutions we're talking about, but for Muslims themselves to understand that, you know, on the one hand, yes, be engaged, but on the other hand, understand what it is you're being engaged with. You know, we don't want to put people off interacting, but it's not the be all and end. That process is not the be all and end all. It's part of just continually interrogating people, but we need to do much more than that. We need to be having confidence to try and take control of narratives, which is in a way an impossible task, and it's not something that individual Muslims should be feeling the weight of it all on their own shoulders. But at the same time, we don't want them to feel scared either. We do want people to get up and try and speak out however they can.
Yeah, very symptomatic, this kind of lack of possibilities in terms of complaints about racism. And there is another research project that is finished now, that was based in the Center for Social Studies, that is called Tolerance, that did European-wide research concerning some of these problems of racism, and among other things, that was interesting to see and really concerning was this recurrence in the way that even though the different countries do have specific institutions to which racism complaints can be addressed, the problem is not recognized as such, and people do have to, I mean, the point of departure is that they do have to prove racism. So that is seems to be very European-wide problematic that would be important to address.
It's one of the ironies actually of this country, of the United Kingdom, that where we did have a sort of move towards some sort of understanding of not having to prove it, although there were two tiers, you know. For example, Muslims were not covered by this understanding under the law, but Jews and Sikhs were, or generally racism, okay, seen as colour racism. We are actually moving away from that model quite rapidly towards something that you've just identified as more European, which is that you have to go back to proving the point.
Yeah.
And it again becomes about you being the individual with the weight of the world on your shoulders trying to make...
Yeah. And it connects a lot to this kind of invisibilization, or maybe invisibilization is even a very soft word, right? Mm-hmm. To denote kind of the way in which many populations in many European countries simply are produced as not there, or if there, then only violent or problem, right? And this connects to kind of this. There are two more points I want to touch on in relation to this Islamophobia. And I'm asking a lot about Islamophobia and racism because I think it's important to kind of also achieve an understanding of what is the framework within which you and also the Islamic Human Rights Commission
are working, right? The social, the political, the cultural frameworks, also in terms of history. But there is another theme that is very recurrent in racist and Islamophobic discourse, and in racist and Islamophobic practice that is connected to gender, I think. And according to this idea or this representation, the Muslim woman is reduced to the status of being a victim, and more specifically of a victim of, not of racism, not of Islamophobia, but a victim of the Muslim man. A victim of, also of her religion. I think that perhaps an intersectional analysis of these dynamics might suggest that the Muslim man is in this dominant colonial hierarchies as they are expressed today, below the Muslim woman, in the sense that, that he is seen as the perpetrator of irrational and superstitious and misogynist violence. He's seen as kind of that representation of the Muslim man ultimately puts him kind of as the primary target of Muslim or not Muslim of anti-Muslim discourse, Islamophobic action. So, I think, what would you say to this analysis? How could you, perhaps nuance it? But what is your, because this is kind of my understanding or my reading of things that are going on today, but not necessarily, I don't know what you would say to that.
I think you've hit upon the sort of prevailing trope of the last decade or so in particular, but it's been there time immemorial, you know, this kind of completely alien figure to what is understood to be a properly constituted human being, and that on the one hand was Muslims in general, but the Muslim man has become a very kind of specific target, to the point where you can say, where you've identified, if you like, hierarchies of power within which you can put sort of hierarchies of people and who are acceptable as kind of human beings. There's a kind of liminal point right at the bottom there where you can see Muslim women are kind of, on the one hand, seen to be somehow within this category of non-human mass, and on the other hand, well, maybe just something you could save and somehow integrate into the lower tiers of what it means to be a properly constituted human. It's the kind of very duplicitous state, actually, because it's a sort of promise, if you like, to certain constituencies around the world for a better life, based on the fact that their issue is about gender, as you said, and not about Islamophobia or racism or structural issues of disempowerment that cross over many, many sections, and disempowerment ultimately coming from Western European, North American kind of structures of global hegemony rather than, you know, other things that are going on. Yeah. The Muslim man just is not on that borderline, he's just way below there. And he has become the, on the one hand, an existential threat that actually doesn't exist, and on the other hand, is a victim, if you like, in the proper sense, of the full gamut of state intervention. So now you suddenly have this whole constituency of people who really are understood in the public psyche and deliberately made to be understood to be so as worthy of, frankly, imprisonment. You had it with Guantanamo Bay. These are all these kind of bagram and these spaces where, although you have had women prisoners, they've been overwhelmingly male because it's been constituted as that kind of proper space for control of this deviant population, which is a mass. So I think, yes, you've hit on it quite precisely. However, it doesn't remain contained there. You see spillover time and time again. And as I mentioned before, we see all these kinds of models of domination as applicable to other groups. We talk about minorities because we talk about the kind of nation-state example where we are kind of having to advocate on a practical level, but it actually is a, becomes a global issue. It becomes about power and how you justify taking power in other places. And there, people are no longer minorities, they're majorities, but there's a intricate relationship between the demonization of minorities and the ability to then go and dominate majorities elsewhere, which again we often forget when we're stuck in this kind of nation state cage.
As you mentioned
before, it is a kind of bind that on the one hand you're forced to accept a nation state identity on the other, and that breaks the kind of links that actually conveniently supersede that. I lost my point, so maybe if you go to the next point.
That also connects, that also allows to see the connections between racism in one place or Islamophobia in one place and imperialism in the other, and the justification or legitimation of that. But we will get back to the issue of imperialism and also human rights in a moment. But in terms of this question about the Muslim man as he's kind of constructed in dominant the dominant imaginary, and also in terms of practice, you know, because in practical terms what happens is that he's targeted, that he's imprisoned more than especially targeted. How can Muslim women or the Muslim community in general perhaps better meaningfully engage in work of liberation that does not obey this logic of dehumanization of the Muslim man, and also of course of the Muslim community as such, but you know, taking these the kind of current characteristics of the practices against Muslims.
I think a lot is already being done, but again, this the prevalence of fear within communities is actually the factor that I think mostly impacts on the kind of solidarity that needs to be had between, let's say, Muslim women and Muslim men, because I really can't emphasize it enough as to how kind of almost justifiably paranoid it has become in a lot of communities. Across Western Europe in particular, but also we found with our research in North America, which we were not expecting it to be really as severe as we found it to be, and that on the one hand it's necessary for you to express solidarity with Muslim men who have been targeted in this way, even when it is actually those few people who you would not really agree with at all. Yeah. And we had this kind of scenario a couple of years ago in the UK where Abu Hamza, who's a kind of notorious demonized figure in this country, was being extradited to the USA, even though the pretext on which he was being extradited was really, under the law even, quite ridiculous, and only really happened because of political momentum. That really needed a kind of solidarity that didn't happen because of the fear of association by both men and women with that cause, because it was a sort of ready-made suicide recipe for your organization, for you as a person, individually, etc., etc. It was a huge risk to take, and most people didn't take it. And it's actually trying to break that climate of fear on the one hand, and on the other hand, actually being realistic as to, you know, it is quite reasonable for people to be afraid. You know, it's creating that momentum whereby people can do that. That's not to say we don't need to have conversations as Muslims about any number of issues internally, but those are our conversations to have. And I think that's where, unfortunately, a kind of institutional interventions over the last 10 years or so have been quite successful in creating misleading expectations of liberation on the parts of many constituencies, including groups of Muslim women within both minorities in sort of Western states and majorities in other states, somehow seeing an avenue for liberation by working with certain terms, working with certain governments, implementing certain programs within communities that offer a kind of notion of, you know, liberation, women's liberation, or transformation of gender relations in society, but which actually really just perpetuate the demonization of other sectors of society, mm-hmm. including other Muslim women ultimately, who don't conform to those expectations of what is the right way to be liberated. Mm-hmm. So it goes back again to control of language. It completely destroys the expression of transformational liberation as a woman through any other way except for this kind of very narrow positivist language that even is up for debate amongst Western feminists, never mind what's being implemented as a universal form of female liberation onto the Muslim and not just the Muslim world, in fact many other countries in the South, communities in the South. So what Muslims need to do is actually break out of those cycles. One of the biggest problems is that problem of fear, and that's where a lot of us are stuck. We can have endless kind of critical conversations as to why people might become complicit in certain discourses, but we have to also be realistic about why many people are just afraid to even engage.
This connects to kind of the last question I have in terms of this theme. Because you have recently written a piece that is entitled No One Expects the Spanish Inquisition Except Muslims and Jews. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us what you mean by this?
Well, the actual phrase No One Expects the Spanish Inquisition is a part of a sketch from the 1970s, late 1960s in the UK, which has become part of kind of British comic history, and everybody knows it without even sort of knowing what it's about. But It was a sketch about the Spanish Inquisition just turning up anywhere, and of course nobody expects them, and the joke was that they would turn up on the bus mm-hmm. on the way back from school and interrogate you as to why you're eating sweets when you shouldn't be eating sweets, and all these kinds of silly things. And thus the Spanish Inquisition, in at least the kind of anglophonic humour, became this kind of funny notion of something that happened. And me growing up in the UK, I was taught at school that the Spanish Inquisition was bad, it resulted in the expulsion of a lot of Jews and Moors. Moors was not kind of really explained as to what these people were. There were some people who were in Spain but who are no longer in Spain, essentially what we learnt, age about 10 or 11. And I used that phrase partly because it was current at the time, because that band of comedians has reformed and it's a huge hoo-ha. But also to explain kind of the dilemma that's actually facing a lot of excluded communities, particularly Muslims, and when you actually start looking at historical processes of what happened in Spain and what the Spanish Inquisition actually was, there is, an understanding that we as these demonized communities do expect that. We do expect to be interrogated quite literally now and made to comply with dominant narratives or face the consequences. And the consequences, just as they were then, which were quite serious, which everybody forgets about the Spanish Inquisition because of this joke, was essentially expulsion, it was forced conversion, and it was ultimately also ethnic cleansing and genocide. And we're at a point now where we are being forced to comply to certain forms of language. Nobody's forcing us to become Christian, but they are kind of forcing us to become, or try to become, this kind of liberal citizen, for want of a better phrase, who is bereft of any kind of or has extracted themselves rather than being bereft of any of their kind of cultural norms that they may have come with. They are completely in tune with the ideas of quote unquote liberal democracy, etc., etc., in a very uncritical way. The point I wanted to make about that was that actually, if you do learn from the Spanish Inquisition, then it doesn't matter how much you do that, how much you try to assimilate, actually ultimately you aren't actually ever going to be accepted. And that is what eventually happened with the Spanish Inquisition, that even the people who did convert or pretend they converted or whatever it was, they were assumed to have been pretending to convert, and ultimately even they were expelled, even they were removed from the political space. And that's an important lesson for us, and that's something that we really do need to kind of integrate, and some of us already have integrated, the fact that we do expect the Spanish Inquisition, and it doesn't matter however much we try to mould ourselves, whether through an actual belief in the superiority of these values or just because as a survival strategy to try and somehow assimilate to these norms, it isn't in the long term going to work. You may create this kind of period where you have this sort of hybrid community or communities, but it's, if we do learn that lesson, it's really just not going to happen. We're never going to be accepted. We are more likely to be violently excluded. And in fact, if we do start looking at the problem now, we are being violently excluded. You mentioned earlier about invisibilization, and you said it might be a mild term. Yeah. It is, in fact, violent exclusion. It's not always with guns and bricks and bats, but it's becoming increasingly like that. And the reason it's becoming increasingly like that is because it has been a completely violent expulsion from the psyche of the dominant community. It's a complete rejection of any kind of language of transformation, and not just the rejection, but the demonization of it as well. So we are forced out in every single way possible. And now the force of arms is also coming, whether it's by states or whether it's by non-state actors, but it's becoming more and more apparent.
Yeah, and in that sense also kind of there's a process of expulsion already taking place, at least in a figurative sense in most cases, because there are also specific cases where people are. But we've been talking a lot on Islamophobia until now, and less of human rights. To make the link, perhaps, or a soft passage to this other theme, maybe we could speak a bit about the relationship between human rights and Islamophobia. So in the sense that to what extent are human rights, or the way that human rights are used in a dominant society, to what extent are they complicit with Islamophobia, and to what extent can human rights be used against Islamophobia?
When we started the organization, there were two sort of trajectories that we thought we would be able to interact in this space regarding human rights. One was the fact that human rights was a language we thought we could have a kind of common discussion about rights, and therefore things like Islamophobia and racism would naturally fall within that, okay, that these are violations of people's rights as individuals and communities. That was very soon kind of dispelled as what we thought was a given, maybe rather naively, that people would somehow think that that's a natural conversation to have. And what we found is that whilst, and we know this from, you know, even people in the human rights community who do not come from this background understand that, you know, there is a hierarchy even of rights, and the rights of the individual trump the rights of the community, they trump economic and social rights. And part of the reason of that is that the West is supposedly the realm of the individual, and therefore protection of that individual becomes a kind of state project, and it's the sort of myth of what human rights are, as opposed to the right to be able to eat or have good drinking water or not be murdered by invading armies or be have the wealth of the nation extracted by the government that you didn't put there in the service of the West, which is of course defending the rights of the individual who's been, you know, being violated because of FGM or this or that or the other, whatever is the current discourse of human rights intervention in various countries. So that was a kind of bruising experience for us, and it woke us up from this kind of naivety that there's a kind of innocent conversation to be had around human rights. Human rights is a very loaded term, and I think it's become accepted by all parties in a way that this is in fact a discourse of Western intervention. And where you stand on this is whether you think that intervention is benign, and where you think it's actually very, very harmful, if not malicious, and etc., etc. So we've sort of seen a redrawing of that. So for us then, where does human rights interact with Islamophobia? We still need to have a conversation and a language and a way of discussing how racism and Islamophobia violates humanity. It's not just about the individual, it's about communities, it's about everybody. Like I said, the domination hate model also sees people within the majority as being victimized by it, because the structure destroys everybody. and it can also save everybody. So that's where we are trying to have that interaction, but it is very difficult because of the way human rights discourse is set up. That natural conversation with a little bit of tweaking isn't going to happen. When we started out, we were always saying, okay, many people don't want to accept human rights, not because they don't believe in justice, but because when the human, you know, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was drafted, it was a very kind of parochial group, albeit they were from different parts of the world, but they only really took things from Western traditions, and therefore people don't have ownership of that discourse. Mm-hmm. You know, and we said, sort of again, maybe rather naively, I don't know, that okay, we need to open that process up and rediscuss this, okay, so that everybody feels ownership of it. And it may be that even 99% of what was in the Universal Declaration is agreed by everybody to be sound and true. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's the case, but it may well be. But the thing is, at least everybody will feel that they came to that conclusion. We think this is now kind of, you know, yes, that's the ideal, but yeah, that's also not going to happen,
yeah,
in the way that you would like it to happen. So therefore, what do we do? And for us, it's just about starting the conversation all over again with other people who also want to kind of reimagine the world, yeah, without repeating the mistakes of trying to make one discourse dominant within it. And also being quite mindful that things like Islamophobia and racism underpin how we have to understand and re-understand rights and dignity, and also what it means to be a human. Because one of the issues which I touched upon before, and which is problematic in the way we talk about human rights now, is that what constitutes a human? Mm. And we are in a situation now where all over the world human rights are being protected by violating the human rights of other people because they're not considered to be human. So there is a problem somewhere,
yeah,
along the way in that ontology, in the, yeah, way it's been, you know, ultimately expressed as to what it means to be human. And for us, this is where we went, tried to kind of go back to Islamic texts and see where is it that people are, you know, unconsciously receiving their inspiration from. You know, everybody is not a scholar, that they will sit down and have a kind of very deep understanding of what's in the Quran or other texts. But certainly there's still a feeling that drives people. And then there came the process of having to then move beyond a kind of colonized discourse of what Islam is as well, because we've had a problem whereby only until very recently we haven't had a kind of nation state or culture that's dominant enough to try, not even succeed, but try and take hold again of language. And what we've had instead is, you know, the political colonization that took place, which was also a cultural and a philosophical domination. So we've had the Quran translated into languages and concepts and then translated back to us. So suddenly, you know, jihad, yeah, as I mentioned before, the greater jihad is the individual one. Therefore, you know, you don't have to be worried about society, you know, just be your happy little individual and,
yeah,
we'll do the rest type of,
yeah,
argument coming out. And that's been a long process, and we're only a small part of that conversation. But for us, it's where we're located, as you said, the south and the north. It's for us to then try and push this out, both amongst Muslims and amongst fellow travellers, to reconstitute a language of justice whereby we can have effective conversations and then also try and raise our own understandings of ourselves and how we fit in the world. Because one of the other impacts of that demonized discourse of human rights, whereby some of us are not worthy of those rights, is that we internalize that and we start believing that, even unconsciously, that we somehow bring blame on ourselves by the way,
yeah,
we act. And again, try to modify. We're either being forced to modify or we're self-modifying our behavior in ways that only just disempower us as individuals and as communities and perpetuate really unequal power relations, as the polite phrase of what is happening on a daily basis to most of the people in the world.
Yeah. This issue concerning the notion of the human being in human rights. So now we're getting a bit abstract, but
sure.
I think perhaps this is not abstract, and in a sense it's also very very practical, because this issue connects also the dehumanization that we've been talking about is a very real and not an abstract idea, right? It's a very real practice that
happens on a daily basis. But you have criticized in some of your writings this implicit or current notion of the human being in human rights discourses and practices. And you have highlighted also how this idea is tied to the racist and historically constituted notion of a human being. Maybe can you expand on this criticism a bit, and perhaps do so or complementing this criticism or using the notion of anas expand upon this criticism. And here we're going so to kind of the more these other grammars of human dignity theme, sure. Because it's kind of this other understandings, this other ways of thinking about the world, but also of being in the world.
As we touched upon, this idea of human rights as the rights of the individual having primacy over everybody was kind of the point of interaction and critique between sort of human rights discourses 20 years ago and what is understood to be even rights, let's say, in Islam. Because whatever, however assimilated your discourse may be, there is an idea that in Islam you have individual rights, but you also have the rights of the community, mm-hmm. and then there's the rights of God. Your rights, you're due to God, right? But that, in a sense, is not part of this discussion, but the idea that the community has rights that are somehow in tandem with the rights of the individual is where there is always a point of critique. The point of the individual as a kind of ultimate expression of what it means to be human is a very Western one, and that there's a sort of idea that that value trumps all other values. Mm. Now we can interrogate that and say there's a lot of hypocrisy about that, and we actually do see that day to day in terms of the fact that that idea is used for interventions in lots of countries about the violations of the rights of individual people who have been imprisoned for their political views, etc., etc., whether it's in China or in the Soviet Union or even, you know, what happened with the fury of the Pussy Riot in Russia today. And yet you'll have many people languishing in prisons who are sort of in the United Kingdom who are quote-unquote political dissidents. We have Muazzam Baig, who was a former Guantanamo detainee, has just been arrested and detained in the notorious Belmarsh prison in the UK. That's just a kind of critique of that idea. But on a kind of theoretical level, that point of difference, we needed to interrogate where that came from, because for us, and this is where, again, assimilationist discourse has sort of started to seep into a lot of quote-unquote Muslim countries or Muslim-majority countries, with that idea of there being community rights, whatever they may be. When I'm not community, I don't mean Muslim community, I mean the sort of society as a whole having kind of certain rights, as well as groups within that. Where did that come from? Because ultimately you're getting people sort of leaving that idea and going to, okay, everybody has this kind of individual right to dissent, and that's what it is we're protecting, when effectively what you're just protecting is certain key people having certain views. And what we found when we sort of referred to people like Sheikh Al-Asi, whose concept of anas we've been using more and more in our work, is that there's a kind of fundamental distinction between what it means to be a person or a human. Human, again, is a loaded term because it has a kind of derivation that has certain ontological understandings as well of that sort of, if you like, enlightened or Cartesian man, in a man, very specifically a man, who exists in a certain way. And Nas, as has been translated for years and years because of colonial domination, is the Arabic word in the Quran for what we are told is human, and therefore if we believe human to be that kind of model, we're forever trying to explain text in a way that will never make sense according to that model. When you go away and look at what anas means and what it kind of derives from, the phrase that Arzu uses is social being. Okay, so on the one hand you exist, but you do not exist in isolation. It doesn't mean that you as an individual don't have rights. Okay, it doesn't mean that we're all kind of a morass that has no kind of either agency or responsibility or rights owed to them. But it does mean that you don't exist in isolation of anybody else, not in isolation of any other Muslim, you know, coming from an Islamic point of view, but from anybody else, anywhere on the entire planet. The whole sort of mass of the world population is interconnected. And once you start bringing that understanding in, you then kind of defeat the process of otherization, because it's very easy to do. Okay, we can continuously criticize, quote unquote, the West for doing it, but that becomes the kind of model which everybody's internalizing. And so in all the sort of decolonized states, you don't actually have decolonization, because you just have reproduction at a political level of everything that went before. And those processes of otherization continue and are manifested in all sorts of extreme and violent ways. If you start then thinking about social being and bringing that into every aspect of how you understand rights, how you understand constitutional issues for a state or any other type of political entity, because again, these things start interrogating ideas like the nation state. What is a nation if we are all somehow interconnected? Why does nation become a kind of determining factor as to how we politically organize? You start being able to open up a whole new space of not just conversation but organization. And so for us, Anas, with that type of derivation, is a very, very important thing for us to be opening up and having a conversation about. And actually, as Muslims, say, well, hang on a minute, I think we've got something here. You know, that's a good way of moving forward. Let's talk about this as Muslims, but also, as I said before, with fellow travelers. Okay, we think this is useful. Do you agree? Because for us, it seems quite clear that apart from a few individuals, increasingly this idea of the human as the recipient of rights is not something that applies to us. I always remember a year after we started IHRC, actually, I went with some colleagues to Turkey and we met a prisoner who we'd been campaigning for, who I suppose would be described in a meaningless way as an Islamist, but you know, somebody who came from a kind of politically Islam background. At that time there was had been a soft coup in Turkey, and a kind of essentially civilian government with the military behind it was in power. And we were telling him, okay, look, we've raised your case here, there and everywhere. You know, it was quite amazing that we even got to meet him. And he said, I hope you're not describing me as a human rights case. What? He said, I don't want to be known as that. And he was quite aggressive about it. He said, I don't want to be known as that. He did not want to be tainted with that language, because he had that understanding of what it meant. You know, this kind of political dissident, almost kind of superstar.
Yeah.
You know, and he didn't want to be complicit in that language. And at that time, I remember sitting there thinking, well, I know this guy's had his toenails pulled out. I know he's been tortured quite brutally. Why on earth would he care? Surely he'd just want us to be able to get him out. But he was so adamant that he didn't want to be complicit in that, that he didn't want us to even use that phrase. Alhamdulillah, eventually he was released after several more years after that time. But it's something that I think we're now beginning to realize now is something that he understood, kind of rotting in a prison with no hope almost of being released at that time. We just didn't think he would get out. Saw it as an urgent project, much more so than us naively trying to kind of make a system work that was never ever going to work, you know, in a way that was meaningful for even him. And I think this is what that conversation is now about, is kind of growing up and understanding that you cannot make something that's broken work. We have to find alternatives, and actually there are good precedents. We don't have to reinvent things.
Yeah.
We have to look for things that already existed. We tend to forget that the world did exist before 1492, and there are lots of worlds existing that resist the violence that's been continuously perpetuated over the last few hundred years of colonial dominations. And there's plenty there to learn from. You know, we get a bit arrogant and we think either we've got to start it all over again or we can just make the dominant discourse work. Actually, no, there's a lot that can be done. We just have to be humble and find a way to do it.
We're going to come back to Anas in a moment. Before that, I think it's important kind of to maybe spell a bit more out the relationship that we touched upon earlier about human rights and imperialism and colonialism. Because, I mean, we've talked a bit about this the limits of human rights in relation to how they are actually used to suspend the rights of other people or to legitimize aggression against other people, be it inside the nation state, but also outside in relation to other countries that might indeed be trying to construct something different. I mean, they might have political projects that they try to do something different than the neoliberal model of organization that is kind of the seen as the normal way of organizing also at the level of nation states. And the idea now, before going to more into depth with these other grammars of human dignity, is to speak a bit more about this. And to me, this is important in the sense that it this relationship between human rights, racism, and imperialism, if you will, mm-hmm. kind of to it's also part of what frames the condition of southern subjects inside Europe as well, because mm-hmm. many of us do have our homes in Europe, and we also have our homes or our ancestors' homes in other places in the world, where in that sense we are perhaps existentially more interconnected or more global and less national than in our way of seeing and of understanding the world than other people. At least we do have that perspective of what happens in our countries, our other countries, also affect us in a very immediate level, right? So can you tell us a bit more about this relationship in relation to human rights, imperialism, and colonialism?
I think there's a good point of intervention into that question. It just struck me as you were talking was what Malcolm X tried to do during the 1960s, and where he actually departed in a way from what Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement were doing. And that was actually about trying to make the language of human rights work, but he actually was using the term human rights to talk about what was happening as opposed to civil rights. Now, what has kind of happened with this human rights discourse, and it was something he couldn't do. I mean, what he did manage to do was internationalize what was happening in the US, whereas the civil rights movement was trying to kind of, or had a trajectory of trying to make things change internally. Malcolm X was about internationalizing the struggle. The phrase he tried to use was human rights, and which we've interrogated was problematic. But for those of us who are based the South, as the South in the North, as you said, we are continuously faced with this dissection of what rights are. So anytime we complain of racism, it's not about human rights, it's about civil rights. Human rights is something more pure, something more, the violation of which is even worse in a way. It's kind of implicit in that, which is about that kind of ideal individual and what that individual represents ultimately. You know, these are not necessarily spoken, but this is what's implicit. And for us, racism is a kind of civil rights struggle, and it's important, but it's, you know, just about you kind of getting socialized into the community without being kind of harassed. It's almost like a two-way thing that you, so long as you interact, we shouldn't be bad to you, and therefore that's a civil rights struggle. You know, I'm being cynical, but that's a kind of conversation that we are practically bound up in a lot of the time. Whereas human rights are the things that the deserving people have and which are violated. When they are violated, it is quite cruel. So, you know, being a victim of racism isn't sort of as deserving of, whether it's as an individual or as a structural problem, however you constitute it, it's not as deserving of condemnation. And that's the imperial project, if you like, within nation states or within a kind of Western European, North American political space. And I think we haven't sort of developed beyond that struggle of the 60s, if you like, albeit we have different expressions of what's going on, but we're stuck in that bind that the experience and the structural working of racism is sidelined completely, and we are sort of stuck in that. And at the same time, the elevation of human rights as something worthy of defending is then exported over our heads, and I think it's important because we have no kind of connection to it. So whilst there's a critique of us as being complicit, and it is true, kind of complicit in these states that we are in just by virtue of being in them and having some sort of privilege over the South, in a way that we are also very powerless, you know, that we are, if you like, we are the validation of the idea that human rights need to be exported because we are problematized internally. So it's like if you can solve the problem, the idea is that we are solving problems there so we do not have problems here, as opposed to actually seeing it as simply a justification for interventions. Now, some people may genuinely believe, many people do genuinely believe that they are doing a wonderful liberatory job by being complicit in these projects. And I remember seeing only a year ago photographs of posters from Amnesty International all over, I think it was Washington or wherever, there was actually a NATO conference saying, good job NATO, keep doing good work. And it was a picture of a woman in Afghanistan, I forget what she was doing, but the idea being that NATO intervention in Afghanistan had somehow worked towards liberating women. Now if you're kind of, you know, being blown up in fear of your life, not from so much kind of Taliban or fighters, but, you know, just the general insecurity in Afghanistan, or the fact that it's a completely dysfunctional political entity, it's not a functioning state, you know, you don't really care where that violence is coming from. You're just, you know, being a victim of all of it. All of this is lost. And the idea is that somehow that project was worth it because of that poster, basically poster girl, or for human rights as being somehow liberated, because I guess she doesn't have to wear a blue burqa anymore. We are ultimately just stuck in a repetitive cycle of this language whereby we cannot critique even very, very violent, malicious interventions externally and internally because of these this trope of what it means to be free. You know, human rights is sort of, you know, what you have when you are ultimately liberated. And again, that's very tied to the idea of what it means to be Western, actually, as opposed to human. But ultimately, again, it's seen as the full expression of being alive, and that is to be free in a Western context. We're not allowed to unpack that. We're not allowed to say, actually, you know, I don't think women are liberated in the West. This is like a complete, you know, I'm sure soon people will be able to go to prison for saying that. That's how kind of gagged and censored people are.
Yeah.
And human rights simply is a validation of certain existences as opposed to a transformative discourse, you know, and it's a discourse of legitimation of much worse things. It's increasingly losing its credibility as a discourse of rights, even as a of justice, even as an imperfect discourse. But it is violently presented again and again as a perfect discourse, as almost a divine discourse. Yeah. I mean, even a supporter of it, of that discourse, like Mike Natiev, very openly says it's humanism worshipping itself, it's just reconstituting itself as the type of religion it is supposed to have critiqued and developed away from. It's really actually just another cycle of this kind of hegemonic religious identity. It's not a discourse of rights or belief, it is about chauvinism. And so it ties in as just another facet of a colonial enterprise. It's what Christianity became. It's what any number of things became. It's what democracy has also become. It's a kind of term for actually violent intervention that destroys everybody's agency, and yet somehow we believe it's actually given people the ability to be political beings. Well, actually it's just given people the ability to be killed or starve or lose basic facilities that they had 10, 15 years ago. And so unfortunately, and this is kind of a very sad conclusion, but it's become at best a very dysfunctional discourse for many, many people, and at worst it's become completely complicit in violence, and that's why it's being rejected. And of course we keep seeing that rejection is presented as a kind of a rejection of justice. And actually, in most cases, I think it's actually quite the opposite. It's the fact that it's so frustrating for people to be able to have any justice through that discourse that is actually causing people to reject it. And that's what's making the project of having other ways of speaking about justice so urgent, and also so possible, actually, because that frustration is now becoming very widespread. The dilemma for the South and the North, though, is about socialisation to those norms because of the problems we face on a day-to-day basis. But perhaps that's another discussion.
Yeah, there are many layers, actually, in what you said, because I, among others, was thinking of how, at least in relation to some parts of the world, and those parts of the world being countries with Muslim populations, the imperial imperial intervention and the slaughter of people is legitimized through this gender discourse, and in that sense having the complicity from feminism, right? Where feminism is used against, so in the favor of this racist understanding or dehumanization of other people. While in other countries, like I'm thinking about a country like Colombia, where intervention is perhaps legalized, even it's not a violent intervention in the sense that because the government opens the doors to that intervention, but that is still, I mean, still it's intervention, right? But in that in those kind of interventions, there are other kind of set of what you say of the repertoire that are used, ideas of justice of perpetuating democracy, etc., etc., that are not as gendered, at least, or as drawing upon so much about feminist from feminist discourse as in relation to Muslim populations, which relates back to the issue of gender and the dehumanization, specifically of the specific way in which dehumanization of Muslim populations is carried out. I think we could continue along those lines, but I think it's also very important that we enter more into depth into these other grammars of human dignity, because that was also an aspect of what you were saying before, that. In spite of all these things, other kind of projects are emerging, at least as a potential, you know. So, in terms of that, in terms of that kind of this different ways to think through issues that relate to justice, to our being in the world in a just sense, to democratic interrelationships. Maybe we could take up the two of the concepts that we were talking about before, that were jihad and anas, but also the two additional important notions that, as far as I understand, relate more to
to notions kind of justice, and those being al-Qist and al-Adl. So could you perhaps kind of explain these concepts a bit more, and how they can be also how they can be understood in relation to each other, and of course also in terms of their emancipatory potential or their contribution in relation to
I think I was just struck when we were talking again about the use of gender as a way of intervention. It reminded me of something from about 20 years ago that I observed, and I'll come to that in a second.
Yeah.
And Nas, as I mentioned, has this idea of social being, and it's regardless of, in a way, it's regardless of gender, okay? And the reason I bring that up is because the idea of the human in human rights is ultimately very gendered. It has come from a male idea of what is a human, and it's only in the last 100-odd years that we've had a kind of interrogation of that. And the thing that I was just reminded of when you were speaking was the Fourth World Conference for Women organised by the UN. I was there actually at that time. I was working as a journalist. This was in, I think, 1995. It was in Beijing. And I remember the motto of the conference was, "Women's rights are human rights." And I remember being struck all the time that there didn't really seem to be an understanding of the irony of what was being said at that time, which is a kind of recognition that human rights is, you know, it's a gendered concept. You know, it was, you know, that wasn't the conversation that was being had. It was meaning something else. But actually, it was a very clear statement of what is the problem with the human rights discourse, is that, it, you know, women are an add-on to this. It literally is add women and stir. Okay, it's the exact critique of kind of positivist feminism that even, you know, a kind of Western standpoint theorists would have about positivist feminism. It's actually the same. It's adding women and stirring to this kind of very gendered concept, and it ultimately doesn't work.
Yeah.
And I think it's quite ironic that one of, I don't know if this is a very British thing, but one of the increasing tropes that's used about the West and their superiority over Muslims is the fact that we have feminism. And you'll often find the most quite misogynistic right-wing commentators using that line as a kind of justification for interventions all around the world or for certain policies in the United Kingdom, as they have almost reinvented themselves as being feminists as well. Now, that aside, that takes us to Anas, and that takes us to the urgency of having another way of understanding what it means to be alive. And that is to dispense with all the baggage of that gendered notion. Because that's also another form of otherization. I was just reminded a couple of days ago, about a year or so ago, I can't remember what ridiculous sexist movie we were watching. I was with my children, it was around the Christmas holidays. And my son, who was about 8 at the time, said, "This film is really racist," and seeing as there were not a lot of non-white faces in it, I was wondering whether he was making a very deep point about lack of representation of different cultures within this movie. And I said, "Okay, how?" And he said, "It's really racist against women." And he had picked up on the fact that it was sexist, did not know the term, but was able to understand that, you know, as a group they were racialized, and that actually was very demeaning and very violent against them. And it got me thinking about this particular question, that we have to reinvent those terms or find how they existed before or how they can develop now.
Yeah.
And so social being, anas, is a way that dispenses with the, not with gender difference, but with you know, a gendered superiority of what it means to be alive. Now, al-adl and al-qist are two words for justice that are found in the Quran, which again are meaningful for this conversation. Adl means justice in the sort of abstract sense and in the all-encompassing sense, and adl is a name of God, actually. It means the just, the truly just. And al-qist actually has a meaning that you could sort of say is social justice. This is again from Sheikh al-Arsi's interpretations, which then becomes meaningful when you're trying to have a liberatory project, because you have on the one sense the very abstract, the spiritual, the all-encompassing ideas of justice which affect every kind of conversation you can have, but then there's also an imperative to seek social justice, and these words are used across the Quran in different places to describe different situations. And I'm not a Quranic scholar to sit down and now go, okay, we can use this, we can use that, we need to look at how this works in whatever context. But that's where we can locate a project of having that conversation which dispenses with all the baggage that we have had thus far. And this doesn't mean that we then just replicate everything from various Islamic or Muslim histories. There's that tendency for everyone to go, you know, point to some heinous episode in the past or period of Muslim history, which is, you know, ripe for critique, and no one's saying it's some kind of, you know, perfect community or history of the world, but then using that as a kind of justification for saying you must not look at these concepts and terms. We can dispense with that. We can look at all sorts of things and have that conversation. And, you know, we don't have to throw everything out because something went wrong. You know, we are in a position where by being excluded, we have a whole space. You know, there's a positive side to it that can be free of that baggage that is, you know, if we have been trying to integrate into a political space that didn't want us, but which kept trying to give us all these terms and concepts as a way of assimilation. Well, okay, here we have a space where we don't need any of that. Let's fill it with lots of things that we can then try and rediscussed. And I think it's important to look at the traditions. We shouldn't just, where there are bad examples, kind of dispense with everything. But I think why that issue of gender actually struck me just again now is the fact that Sheikh Arasi pointed out many times in the Quran, al-adl and al-qist are only used together in one place, and that is actually in the surah, which is called the Surah of Women, which is not actually the only surah about women. The whole Quran is addressed to everyone, but which has some specific points, and one of the points and where this is used, and it's actually the controversial part, or one of the controversial parts in the Quran, which is about polygamy, which nobody can kind of get around, and talks about permissibility of having four wives. And this is a trope that is invented and reinvented and then internalized by Muslims.
Yeah.
You know, this kind of, you know, the whole seraglio and, you know, harems and four wives and endless concubines and all the rest of it being kind of, on the one hand, being the orientalized picture, on the other, projected for a few hundred years and, you know, ultimately determining an identity against the Muslim other on a huge, grand, global scale, but then also being used to justify all these demonization we've been talking about on a very local level in the current age. Those two terms are used because of, within the phrase, where there is social breakdown, whereas there's a complete lack of social institutions, and you have a situation where women with children are widowed and bereft and completely without support, there is a permissibility because of al-qist to ensure safeguarding their existence in terms of just being able to eat and survive, and this sort of thing of having more wives. Now, I've gone deliberately for the kind of controversial part of the Quran, or a controversial part of the Quran, because A, we will never escape them. Okay, but B, also because when you dispense with all this kind of orientalized baggage about what does that mean, you actually find all sorts of things coming up, and al-qist and al-adl being the only place in the whole Quran where it's determining about, if you like, protecting the vulnerable. It's not about protecting women per se, and that therefore to protect all women of the world, every man must have four wives. It's a very, very specific example of where you have to kind of look at social scenarios and social collapse and have interventions, that it gives us a way of looking at things, and then you can unpack all the other examples. You know, okay, you understand where not to universalize things, you understand what in that context does social justice mean? I mean, we're using that as the translatable phrase, but, you know, maybe there are other ways of having communication across languages, which is not just about how we can roughly approximate things, but okay, what is there in traditions about how to exist as communities, how to have institutions, how to formulate political decision making, that at the heart of it is about justice, and how do we imagine relations between peoples, whether they're communities based on ethnos or religion, or whether it's about gender interaction. How can we address a lot of the problems that we have without having to concede that somehow we are the teleological inferiors of people who rule us because of virtue of force of arms rather than force of ideas? And that's the kind of place where we can have that intervention. Of course, I'm a Muslim and I have certain attachment to those principles, and I want to find out more about them from that tradition, and I want to share them. But it's a collaborative project whereby we can find the pluriversal way of reconstituting communities, reconstituting existing, that dispenses with all the other problems. It sounds very utopian, again, another loaded word with another history, but we have to try. We have to try and utilize the space that we have been exiled into, yeah, to create a place to exist on our own. You know, it is somewhere we've ended up as a result of violence, but at the same time we need to challenge that. And the conversation is as important as any other kind of activism we undertake to deal with the way we've been pushed out.
I'm thinking, while you were talking, I was thinking about whether, I mean, I was concretely reminded of a lecture I saw with some students, actually, mm-hmm, in Denmark, by an African American or African Jamaican scholar called Lewis Gordon, where he talks about many things, but among others, he touches upon the notion of Ubuntu, mm-hmm, and explains how there is a kind of also a narrowing down of that expression when it's simply translated as an African notion of justice, yeah, right? Because in that translation, many of the different broader aspects of Ubuntu, and maybe also the philosophical and spiritual underpinnings of this kind of notion, are kind of swept onto a side or away to translate into a Western concept. And he also problematizes this specific act of translation, because it presupposes that justice is a complete concept, a complete idea, whereby then other ideas can just be translated into, right? And say, well, how about translating justice as an incomplete Ubuntu or something like that? Well, he doesn't say this literally, yeah, but this is something that I take from what he's saying. So I was thinking a lot about that in terms of also of Al-Kistan al-Adl, right? So my invitation perhaps now is what if we take the notion of Anas, and you talked about this interconnectedness, right? So and then these notions of justice. Now we having in mind that kind of criticism in terms of translation as well, but how would a jihad? I mean, what? How does that kind of fill out this jihad? For example, right?
Yeah. How I don't. You know, I like the idea of justice as an incomplete Ubuntu. I think it sums up exactly what the problem of mistranslation is, or yeah, not even that, but the direction in which things are translated.
Yeah.
And the translation of jihad in that context of it being an expression of trying to implement justice, okay, is or incomplete Ubuntu, or, you know, or in fact, actually more specifically, Al-Qist, because it's a function of trying to create, whether through force of arms or whether through some other kind of social project, social justice, which again, I mean, the UK, we had this whole thing about the social, you know, social justice being the agenda of the new Labour government. So when we as Muslims are talking about social justice, we're not talking about a kind of neoliberal, slightly left agenda of UK. We're talking about all sorts of things to do with, you know, right to eat, right to exist. It's not just about going to school, it's about the fact of, you know, what kind of world you live in. You have to reimagine a destroyed country, or you have to reimagine a country which is full of structural issues, as in the UK, or a destroyed country like Afghanistan or Iraq, or the fact that to even think about countries and think about social justice that goes across borders, okay? And so the aspect of jihad within that is how really jihad becomes functional then, okay? What is it that you do? Okay, what is your struggle? How is that going to be manifested? And jihad is a worthy thing, you know, it's something which is full of value. And for Muslims to have had that value turned into almost a criminal act, okay, it's psychologically, it's very violating, you know, it makes everything you do good, something that you should be ashamed of, and it internalizes then even more problems, if you like, as more than we're already carrying as victims of kind of racialized violence. So jihad has to be, you know, if you like, it's a transformatory process, but it has to be transformed in our own psyches back into part of that discourse which is not related to the things that it translates. So we often have jihadist struggle. That's what it's been kind of, to try and make it acceptable, you say jihadist struggle. Maybe the way to do it, and this is again struggling for terms, is to make understand jihad as a function of implementing social justice. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the method, and what it is, lesser or greater, is something else that we can discuss. But you know, jihad in itself is functional, and it's good. You know, it's a good thing to do. And if people do things which are wrong, well, then that's another thing. I call it whatever, but the overwhelming love of it and the need for it cannot be touched anymore by that negative discourse. So it's, again, it goes down to control of language and how we can actually regain control of language. Not so that we can then control people, but then that we can have the conversations we need to have to create a different world or a better world, or transform the world, because all of these concepts have things that we can share, but they also have their particular base, and we need to liberate ourselves. That sounds rather airy-fairy, but you know, we do need to be able to kind of break that cage, which you quite rightly defined the way jihad is being defined for ourselves.
Yeah.
And we can only do that by first of all accepting that, you know, in our own minds, that we don't have to feel that. And that's the urgent project. That is where jihad comes in, that it becomes a jihad. You know, that, I don't want to use the word struggle, but that need or necessity to break those chains, those mental chains. I think yesterday I remember I reused the quote of Steve Biko, that the greatest weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. We have to free our minds. And that, again, sounds like a very blasé thing, but it's actually, it is the core of the project. Yeah. And coming back to controlling what we say, or at least controlling the conversation, the terms of the conversation, without replicating domination. And I don't think that's as hard as it seems, because once we're out of that space where we're in a cycle of being dominated, you don't necessarily repeat that. You know, part of the reason for repeat is being stuck in the system. We are in an excluded space. Let's benefit from it rather than just be destroyed by it.
Yeah. In terms of kind of this situation, which is kind of a confinement, right? Mm-hmm. Also the cage, the confined situation. I'm thinking about the kind of perhaps necessary balance to kind of nurture kind of inside the in this case the Muslim communities, right, and the world's words and the values that can be spoken about and enacted, you know, and what way they can do that. And also on the other hand, the
kind of the dimension of trying to open up that caging. I was thinking also specifically of a text that Nelson Maldonado Torres wrote about Césaire and about the gift understood in the sense that Maldonado Torres is presenting ultimately Aimé Césaire's discourse on colonialism as a gift also for not for only the colonized, but of course specifically because it's something that tries to think through the problems and speaks in a different language as well about these problems, but a gift to humanity as such. And the question, an important question for me also to address, is to the degree to which it is possible to, the degree to which it makes sense, I don't know, but you know, to speak kind of more outwardly. In the sense, I mean, in terms of possibilities of change and of breaking this cage we've been talking about, right? The possibility even of that the dominant society might receive the gift that are these other contributions that at this moment as actually are labeled as, represented as something that is completely different, basically. This also happens in a different way, but within indigenous people's projects in Latin America, we still find all across the academia, across the media, people saying that, yeah, but these people would just want to go back to the past, as if, you know, as if that was kind of, as if taking up ideas that might help construct a different project is something that, yeah, that is a wish rather to go to the past. So this again, this very racist understanding of other people's projects and capabilities in terms of producing and contributing to fellow or common futures, right? So I'm thinking in terms of that, of what is the, and this is not to be pessimistic, and especially not because, I mean, one of the ideas also of the project of the Alice is one of the core ideas is what can be the mutual learning of what can Europe learn from the global South, right? The question is also, is it willing to, I mean, learning also implies kind of acknowledging maybe an ignorance, and if that is not acknowledged but as represented as I don't know, that these are the kind of my brainstorm right now about these issues, but maybe you have
I think this is the key, it's the key question, that I mean, whether you're talking from point of view of a muted group theory or the domination hate model, or whether you're talking about the kind of interventions about Europe learning from the South, it's ultimately how do the people who control power, it's in their hands, whether they choose to change or to listen or to learn. And as you said, you don't want to be pessimistic, but the point is that when you are powerless, what is it that you can invoke that will make them, those who have power, change? And that, you know, your armory is fairly limited, and even those who would even advocate taking up arms, generally there's not that many kind of positive examples of long-term kind of change. So you have a situation where you had an armed struggle in South Africa, and you've had a kind of regime change, but you also have a kind of a situation where the economy isn't transformed and the wealth of the nation is still in the hands of the same people who kind of legislated apartheid, but you know, now there's no legislated apartheid, but you still have the kind of economic underpinnings of the system that was there before. So on the one hand you have a kind of success that was brought both by civil society action and by armed struggle, but which has been also crushed, and that is a kind of critique that is there but is not expressed politically for various, again, structural reasons that hail from the preceding regime, which is that you can't express those critiques in a kind of meaningful public system because those who have the power simply don't listen or don't want to listen,
yeah,
and don't want to learn. And I think Maria Botelja put this in a paper about a year ago as well, which is, okay, is a question to those in the decolonial struggle, that what is it that we have to offer,
yeah,
that will make those in power, make Europe listen or learn or change? And that is the question that I think nobody's really gotten the answer to.
Yeah.
For me, however, I think there is a kind of equal project that has as much importance and we often forget about it, and that's the conversations we have within struggles. Because one of the problems that we have all had is that we struggle and we are struggling against, whether we call it Europe or a kind of, you know, neoliberal hegemony or colonialism or have on all of these and some more terms, that even when we're in this kind of unidirectional struggle against them, we sort of validate them as well, because it's just us against them. And the fact that we don't link up with all the other peoples, the fact that there's a divide and rule policy, is something that we forget, and it's all about our own quote unquote struggle against this hegemon. And also about our own conversation, our own deal with them. And that's when you start ending up with all sorts of factional infighting, etc., because then we can be all played off, not against each other as different, huge disparate groups, but even internally within communities. So this is, we have a kind of collapse of Muslim cooperation in Middle East and North Africa in the last 3 years as a result of this kind of divide and rule policy, where we're all having conversations with the US or with Europe in isolation of each other. We don't talk to each other. And I think that project is very, very urgent, and if not more urgent. It's not so much what can we give them that they will change, but how do we actually constitute ourselves as an entity? Because numerically, we are more.
Yeah.
The ideas are also more, and the ideas are more, you know, potent and powerful. You know, whether it's, you know, indigenous claims or Islamic claims and all the kind of diversity and multiplicity, there's a lot of richness there, which when we just get into this kind of, I was going to say two-way conversations and struggles, but they're not, they're generally kind of the violence and the conversation is kind of one direction, and we're trying to have a bit of, you know, a little bit of impact in the other way.
Yeah,
that needs to be done, but you know, there's a bigger urgency to have the other more vital conversation, because that's about how to move on, not just about the struggle for survival. You know, it's part of the struggle for survival, which is to make sure we keep talking and having ideas, but it is also the future. And for me, I think, without trying to kind of escape the need for having that conversation and trying to make those who have the power bend or shift or change, we also need to not become chauvinistic in the way we struggle for it as well. We need to be having that vital conversation about the ways we exist and can exist and change the world. So for me, it's about broadening that as well, and it's much more than just hoping. And I guess we hope, if we are believers, then things will change. We just don't know how they will change in transforming all those structural problems and that colonial hold, whenever it's going to happen. But it's not going to happen in isolation of us, not trying to have a different world with all the peoples who are excluded, you know.
And in a sense, that would be kind of, at least momentarily, a way of moving out of that cage, because in the sense that cage is also made precisely by that one channeled
logic of struggle as well, but also of course of oppression, right? But at least leaving it in a sense, or making something else out of it by strengthening and speaking with collaborating with other projects as well. This points back to the pluriversal that you were mentioning very briefly. Perhaps to end, to explain the notion of pluriversality in how it ties to this last issues we've been discussing.
I think you would be better to explain pluriversality than myself. I think if you ask for me and for the kind of projects that we've been trying to do, pluriversality is essential because, as you said, otherwise we're in a kind of cage. We're still in a cage. And we're still all just struggling for either as a recognition of the loss of power for a place within the hegemon, you know, negotiated, whether by a kind of acceptance of some of our identity or by, I don't know, some kind of force of struggle, I don't know, which just then makes us complicit in the otherization of everybody else who's excluded. And for me and for us, you know, we can't, that's not justice, that's just assimilation. It, you know, it's not the victory of a struggle, it's actually the delegitimization of a struggle. It's something that, you know, it's been a process of learning that we have to understand that, you know, we can work together from different backgrounds, from, and even, you know, retain distinct ideas about what is good and what needs to be the future. But at the same time, understand that, you know, this is kind of the area where the good comes from. It's not, you know, and anything else will simply be a form of assimilation, you know, and that we will become part of the problem. It is, if you like, creating an alternative world. I know it sounds very kind of idealistic, but if we don't actually recognize each other, then this whole idea of social being falls to pieces. We tend to, you know, otherwise we have accepted the demonization of everybody else, and we've also just reimagined ourselves as again, the only people who are deserving. And then we've just replicated that whole model of what it means to be human as opposed to working towards something else. Yes, the idea of social being will also encompass everybody within that hegemon. But the thing is, you know, it's not just us and them. It's us and a whole world of us that have been excluded, which we need to, which is the place where we can, not need to, this is the place where we can be social beings, actually. And then that becomes something that you take to the table, as opposed to your individual kind of interventions, which are not really interventions, they're more like polite requests to people who don't necessarily, or who really don't want to listen.
Yeah.
So the pluriversal project for me, at any rate, is that conversation, even in its most basic form, where there is not much exchange, it's still the necessary project and the vital project, and vital not just in the sense of survival, but vital in the sense of being full of vitality, that can and should be done.
Yeah.
But that's it, you can explain the rest.
Okay. Thank you very much, Arzu.
Thank you.